no oil. A spoil in my shoreline, I like fish much better than crud. I like birds and things, a creeping and crawling. Won't trade no more oil for blood. The sun don't give us all we need to make this country run. But that black demon oil's got us fussing and fighting, and I do believe it's time we was done. Kids with leukemia, nuclear power ain't fit for a dog. The sun don't give us all we need to make this country run. But that nuclear power's got us fussing and fighting, and I do believe it's time we was done. Good morning, Toledo, and good afternoon, Columbus, and hello to those of you on the internet watching or listening wherever or whenever you are. My name is Joe DeMar, and you are one of the lucky ones that managed to tune into For a Green Future. For a Green Future is a show where we talk about ecology and the environment, and we talk about them in the ways that they affect you and your wealth, your health, your happiness, the happiness of your friends and family, and the animals around you and the plants. And I have to apologize. I got a little bit distracted at the start of the show here because I was just looking out the window here where I'm broadcasting from. And I saw there's a squirrel in this maple tree next to me. And he is chewing off the ends of the branches that have the immature maple seeds on, those the little propeller type seeds. Right now, those seeds are green and young and tasty for squirrels. And what this squirrel is busily doing is chewing the ends off of the branches and then taking these branches covered in these immature seeds and sticking them into a hollow in the tree. And I didn't even know squirrels did that. I mean, it's a great strategy. I mean, a squirrel can't eat all these immature seeds in one day. There's just too many. So he's busily working away at it. There's actually a couple of them in the tree next to my window, and it's just a reminder that, you know, we're not the only critters that can plan and take actions and do things and change the environment around us, but we're the only ones that we know of that have the ability to completely destroy that environment. So a big announcement at the start. Oh, well, first of all, we have a great show lined up for you today. We have an interview with Linda Gunter. She is from Beyond Nuclear, and we've often had Kevin Camps on. He's also works for Beyond Nuclear. But Linda Gunter has organized an event that's going to be happening worldwide on the internet today at noon, and she's going to be talking about that. It marks the 35th anniversary of the Chernobyl nuclear disaster, of the start of the Chernobyl nuclear disaster. And so she'll be our guest on in about, 15 minutes or so. Actually, more like 10 now. We're almost to that point in the show. Then we'll hear from our advertisers and patrons. And then our wonderful co-host, Rebecca, who will be joining us shortly, is going to get on, and we'll be talking a little bit about Parkinson's disease. Then, of course, we have news and views and information from the ecology networks that are important for you to find out about. And hopefully sometime in this hour, we're going to hear from you at 866-240-1065. This is a call-in show, and I have a very big announcement about this call-in show. This is actually the last time you'll be able to call in at 866-240-1065 because our show is changing channels. We are going to be moving to 100.7 on the dial, which will also be the ticket. Right now we're on WTOD, the ticket. We're going to be moving to 100.7 FM, the ticket in the Toledo market, because this channel, 106.5, has been sold to a conservative Christian organization. It's called the Delmarva Educational Association, and they're going to take this channel over and broadcast conservative Christian stuff. And this is actually part of a nationwide pattern that this is happening all over the country, where these quote-unquote educational foundations, which are actually broadcasting religious stuff, are one by one buying up all the stations, and the eventual goal is to crowd out anything but conservative Christian broadcasting. And it's really a threat to the freedom of speech in the United States of America right now that isn't getting any kind of attention or coverage. This happened previously in Toledo, in the Toledo market, about 5, maybe 7 years ago. There was a station, a small local station, that was broadcasting a bunch of the liberal talk show hosts, people like Tom Hartman and Stephanie Miller, which you may not remember or may not have heard of, because they've been pretty much driven off the radio and into the internet. A few years ago, we had a station that broadcast Ed Schultz, for example, although he has passed on. But this station broadcast these live talk show, liberal talk radio, and a similar Christian foundation with a similar name that had education in the title of it came and bought it and replaced it. To this day, it has very vapid gospel music. So we won't let them drive us off the air, though. Like I say, starting next week, same time, just tune in to 100.7. And I've been assured that the coverage, the area that it covers, is about the same. And it will still be nestled in there amongst the ESPN stuff. If you like to hear environmental news and ecological information, stick with us, make the transition. And of course, our podcast and our YouTube video channels will be unaffected. And those are doing pretty well. We're catching on. We last week on Podomatic, we were number 53 in the news subcategory out of thousands. So we are getting more listeners online. But first and foremost, I love this format. I love talk radio. And I've been sort of binge watching, because we're still mostly COVID isolating, although we do go out some. But I've been semi binge watching that old television series Frasier. I don't know if any of you are old enough to remember that, but it was a situation comedy, a sitcom about a talk radio host who did a on-air psychological help program. And it just reminded me of what talk radio used to be. I mean, it used to be you'd have a talk radio show like this, and everybody would be clamoring to get on, because they wanted their voices heard, and they understood that this medium is one where you can have a profound impact on people. There's something about hearing the human voice that can carry emotion, it can carry persuasion in a way that nothing else can, you know, much better than seeing a meme on Facebook or you know, even watching a YouTube video. There's something about hearing somebody's voice with all the emotion and inflection. And if you can get somebody who's calling in and they really share something that's close to them, they really share part of their life experience with the whole listening audience, there's nothing like it, really. I mean, there's really, it's spontaneous, it's live, it's always live. So please, sometime during this hour, give us a call at 866-240-1065. We're going to be joined very soon by Rebecca, but I think maybe I'm going to go ahead and set up this interview. As I said at the start, today and tomorrow is the 35th anniversary of the Chernobyl nuclear disaster. And it's still being called the worst nuclear disaster in history, although the Fukushima disaster has surpassed it, because for the past 10 years, Fukushima has continued to dump radioactive radioactivity in the world, into the earth. And we have an update story on that too later in the show. But there was nothing like it for drama, for a dramatic accident, because the battles to stop this nuclear reaction, the incredible sacrifices that the soldiers and the plant operators and the people of Belarus who were running this nuclear plant did to try to stop the disaster, to try to stop from making it worse, were just unbelievable. People were literally sacrificing their lives, putting themselves in incredible danger in a way that I think has been kind of unmatched in human history. And it, of course, HBO made an incredibly dramatic series about it just called Chernobyl, which has been called one of the best miniseries in television history, in broadcast history. So if you haven't watched Chernobyl yet, please do, especially since this is the 35th anniversary. And of course, we all know that the whole exclusion zone around Chernobyl is uninhabitable. Human beings can't live there. They're still building a new containment structure over the entire sarcophagus, which is the name for the mountain of cement that they poured on top of the reactor. And, you know, the disaster is still going. So we always have to say, with nuclear disasters, we always have to say the start of the disaster was 35 years ago, but the effects of it are going on for a million years, because that's how long some of these radioactive nuclei are going to take to go through their 10 half-lives and go away. So I think without further ado, I think that's a pretty good setup. You won't be able to call in during the interview, of course, but as soon as that interview's over, let's hear from you. Let's hear it. 866-240-1065. Your last chance to call that number. Okay, Russell, let's go ahead and hear from Linda Gunter at Beyond Nuclear.
Sure, I'm Linda Pence-Gunter. I'm the international specialist with Beyond Nuclear, which is an NGO located just outside Washington, D.C.
Okay, great. And I do want to just wish you a happy Earth Day, since we're recording on Thursday, April 22nd. Tell us about this event you're having this coming Sunday. What's happening, who's involved, and so forth.
Yes, well, I've been working quite a bit with British colleagues, specifically the Greater Manchester and District CND, which is a campaign for nuclear disarmament, an organization called Chernobyl Children's Project UK, and the nuclear-free local authorities. And we were thinking about how to sort of retell the Chernobyl story. You know, each year we mark that anniversary on the 26th, and often we talk about what happened and more from the technical end of things and what went wrong. But we wanted to put the human faces on the story and really look at who's telling it and how are they telling it. And so that led us to putting together an event which looks at both the eyewitness testimonials and the historical research that's been done, but also a novel that was written about the people who experienced the accident, and somebody who works in humanitarian support. And so that's how we put together the event. And the guests we have on, I'm really thrilled about. You're probably familiar with the book Voices from Chernobyl. It's called Chernobyl Prayer in the UK by Svetlana Alexievich, and she is a Belarusian journalist, and she's the person that took these first-hand eyewitness accounts down in her book. And we're going to have a very well-known actor in the UK, Maxine Peake. She's going to read some excerpts from the book at the start of the program. And then we'll have as guests Kate Brown, who's author of Manual for Survival, A Chernobyl Guide to the Future, who's the professor who really looked into what were the real health impacts of this disaster. And Dara McKeon, who's actually an Irish, he was a theater director, but he chose for his first novel the timing of the Chernobyl disaster, looking at different characters as they experienced this, for his novel All That Is Solid Melts Into Air. And then Linda Walker, who's the executive director of Chernobyl Children's Project UK, which works in Belarus, but started out bringing children out for the, what they call radiation vacations. But she realized that they also needed to bring humanitarian aid into the country and sort of change the culture there so these children would be more accepted, get better care, hopefully stay in the families. So those are our guests, and I'm really looking forward to moderating the conversation with them.
Uh-huh. And so how could people, if they want to pursue this or if they want to join, because this is going to be airing on Sunday morning, and I understand it live, it happens Sunday at noon, how can they participate?
It's a fairly simple registration process. We're doing it through Eventbrite, but it will be on Zoom. Probably the quickest way is to go to the Beyond Nuclear International website. So this is a different website to our activist website, which is Beyond Nuclear. That's the organizational website. But beyondnuclearinternational.org is where we run sort of feature articles, and there's one there right now called Living with Chernobyl. If you open that article, right in the first line, there's an intro to the event with a link saying register here. And if you click that, it'll take you to the Eventbrite page. And when you register there, you will automatically get a Zoom link to join the event at 12 noon Eastern U.S. time on Sunday morning.
Okay. And I assume it'll be available afterwards as...
Yes, yeah. The whole thing will be, well, I should say not the whole thing. It will be recorded. The reading that Maxine Peake is doing from Voices from Chernobyl is part of a worldwide project that was initiated out of France, which asked women to recite or read excerpts of this book on the 25th and 26th of April in a public place. But because of copyright issues, it cannot be filmed. So people are doing this, you know, live in various locations. But because we are doing this online, we can't record that section of the program. So that's why we're doing it first. So what people will be able to watch afterwards will be the interviews with our guests and a Q&A from the audience. But unfortunately, that reading from the book will not be preserved in perpetuity, sadly, which is just a function of this copyright issue, which I'm not mm-hmm. completely clear about. But,
right.
but we're not, you know, we're going to play safe. So you really want to be there at noon to hear this, I think. She's a fantastic actor, and the excerpts that she's going to read are extremely moving.
Okay.
And if you saw the Chernobyl television series, which was actually kind of what inspired us to do this, the success of that dramatization of the disaster raise awareness so effectively about what happened in the aftermath that we really thought, you know, that we ought to try to sort of replicate that in some way. And the Voices from Chernobyl was a big source material for that series. And one of the excerpts that Maxine's going to read, you know, will be reminiscent of what was seen in that series. So I think it's well worth tuning in to catch that beginning.
Okay. You mentioned that the children of Chernobyl face some special challenges in terms of being accepted and getting care. Could you give us a little taste of what they're going to be talking about here? In other words, what's it like for the children and the people that are now living in the shadow of the Chernobyl disaster?
Right. Well, as you probably know, Belarus was by far the worst hit country in terms of the radioactive fallout from the Chernobyl disaster. And so the levels of exposure and the lingering radioactivity there is still significant enough to cause ongoing birth defects and other health problems in the communities there, especially in Gomel, which is where Linda's project primarily works. And so what historically happened, what she learned, and obviously I'm paraphrasing what she will talk about on the show much more effectively, was that children born disabled because of the exposure to of the parents to the ongoing radioactivity often resulted in the father leaving the family because there was a sort of stigma and shame of having produced a child with these sorts of physical or mental disabilities. And her organization has sort of worked hard to reverse that cultural thinking, because if the mother was left alone with a child, she often economically couldn't support it, and they ended up in these rather grim orphanages. And so what they've now got are a different set of situations where they've created some kind of family homes where people can live together. Even if the children have been abandoned by the parents, there are adults there who live with them as if they're parents, in a family kind of environment rather than an institutional environment. But they've also tried to help educate people on how to look after the children so the families don't fall apart, and so they're not stigmatized by their neighbors and others because of this event. So she's, I think, really done a remarkable job, not just bringing kind of physical stuff which they need, like medical supplies, but of re-educating the cultural approach to this in Belarus so that families aren't broken up as often. So that's, yeah, I think, a remarkable achievement.
Yeah, so this grim reality of being downwind of a nuclear disaster, I mean, there's nothing unique about the people of Belarus in that this is a potential future for anyone who's living downwind of a nuke plant, because they all have the possibility of this kind of meltdown or disaster. Isn't that true?
I mean, I think, you know, we've seen it, obviously, sadly, history repeat itself in Japan, where you've now got, you know, it's not designated an exclusion zone. Actually, you know, there's obviously a lot of push to say, well, you know, this should be, we should follow the model of the Chernobyl disaster and designate an exclusion zone rather than do what they're doing in Japan, which is endeavor to so-called clean it up unsuccessfully and then encourage people to move back into an environment which is by no means safe for them to live in, especially women, children, pregnant women, you know, fetuses, so forth, you know, that's who are much more susceptible to radiation exposure. So yeah, I mean, we're obviously always looking at the possibility of having an area that is no longer habitable, or this kind of bait and switch where in Japan they just raised the exposure, the acceptable exposure levels by 20 times, you know, to say, well, this is now the healthy limit under which you can live, to justify moving people back into areas that they could not clean up back down to the 1 millisievert a year standard that was in place before. So there's a sort of moral outcome, you know, human rights violation outcome that's also inevitable in the aftermath of a nuclear disaster.
Now, right now, the nuclear industry is making, I guess you'd call it, one last great push to, again, grab all the resources and be the quote-unquote energy of the future, which they've been trying to be for the last 75 years or so. I mean, Bill Gates and other billionaires are dumping tons of money right now into promoting nuclear power and trying to convince us to go down the path of Chernobyl and Fukushima. How do you keep fighting this? I mean, you've been involved in this fight for a long time now. What do we do? How do we keep going in the face of that?
Yeah, well, I think we've got a lot of sort of support now from reality, which is that nuclear power is so expensive, really the most expensive energy technology, and it takes so long to deliver even one nuclear power plant. You just have to look at the situation in Finland, you know, which is 10 years behind schedule, billions over budget. France, the same thing. England, the same thing. So, you know, nuclear power is not helping itself by being incredibly slow and incredibly expensive. And on the other side of the coin, the dramatic advances in renewable energy technology, which you're obviously very familiar with, you know, the green energy environment has changed even over the last several years so phenomenally and is continuing to change. Advances are being made in terms of storage, which will solve the intermittency problem. The prices are just dropping whilst the nuclear prices continue to skyrocket. So to some extent, you know, you could argue, well, it's got no chance really, so we should just sit back and not worry about it. But unfortunately, as you say, the lobbying power is enormous, the influence on Capitol Hill and in the White House is enormous. So we have to continue to put the pressure on and deliver the facts and try to educate our decision makers that if they choose to include nuclear in any kind of climate solution, they are basically dooming their plans to failure, because it's been shown that if you divert funds to a slower, more expensive technology like nuclear, you will save less carbon in the same amount of time that you could have done so much more by diverting those funds to renewables and energy efficiency.
Okay, so we keep getting the truth out there, and that's the best way to counter all this propaganda we're facing.
Well, yeah, I mean, I have sort of mixed feelings about that, because getting the truth out there isn't enough. You know, facts do not set you free. I mean, it seems like we've got to get at core values, you know? We've got to find what it is that matters to the people that we're trying to persuade and show them how renewables and efficiency meet their core values, because just bombarding them with facts doesn't matter, because the other side will bombard them with convincing rhetoric and sound bites, and they believe them. So we're constantly looking for new ways to tell the story. And I think, you know, what this event on Sunday is partly contributing is putting that human face on the story. This is a new, this is a technology that has real victims who suffer and who continue to suffer across the world in many different circumstances, from uranium mining right through to generating electricity, to accidents, to waste mismanagement. There are human faces attached to this story who take the burden and none of the so-called benefits. And if we can put those faces in front of the other faces who continue to advocate for nuclear, that'll prick their conscience pretty sharply, I would think, and hopefully start to help them change their minds.
All right. That was our interview with Linda Gunter. And just to review, if you want to watch this live event at noon today, you would go to Beyond Nuclear International. You'd click on Events and Actions, and then you'd scroll down to the Living with Chernobyl event, and there you would be able to register, and then they'll send you an email link, and you can watch this thing. That's what I'm going to be doing at noon today, so hopefully some of you will join me. Well, so that was Linda Gunter, and now we get to hear from our advertisers and patrons. Yay! ForGreed Futures brought to you by the Wood County Park District. The Wood County Park District is a natural resources conservation agency. They protect natural spaces, maintain quality green spaces, provide engaging programming, and they teach people to love and respect nature. They restore wildlife habitats, and they lead outdoor adventures. Wood County Parks protects natural spaces in Wood County for all to enjoy, from 8 a.m. to 30 minutes past sunset every day of the year. There's several ways to get in touch with them to see what they're up to. One is to call at 419-353-1897. That's 419-353-1897. Another is to go to their website, wcparks.org. That's wcparks.org. And of course, you can download their app, the WC Parks app. Just go to any app store and search for WC Parks. And they are on all sorts of social media, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, etc. So that's the Wood County Park District. And we're also brought to you by our patrons. These are wonderful people who have gone to patreon.com, that's P-A-T-R-E-O-N, searched for For a Green Future. They've got a little search bar there that says find a creator, and you type in For a Green Future and up we pop. And there's some really nice, cool pictures there that describe the different levels of membership. And so you just click on one of those, and once you've signed up, every month a little bit will come out of your checking account, come over to us, and that's really what helps us put on this show. So we're very grateful to our patrons, and especially we had a new patron last week. Becca signed up during our Earth Day Telethon, which we're very grateful for. There's, of course, we have our Becca, our very own Rebecca Wood. Hi, are you on
the line? Speaking of Becca, I am here.
Whoa. Hey, how are you doing?
All right, how are you?
Good, good. The coffee has taken effect, I hope you were.
I'm less cranky, so that's good.
Less cranky, yeah, that is always good on radio. So, and if anyone wants to join less cranky Rebecca and myself anytime in the next half hour, give us a call at 866-240-1065. You can talk about any environmental topic, but one thing I'd like to ask is, what kind of memories do you have of Chernobyl? Where were you? What were you doing? How did the news of this disaster affect you? So, all right.
I had a little ADD tangent when that lady was talking, because when I hear British people talking about nuclear stuff, I always think of the Greenham Common women's encampment in the 80s, mostly because there was a really good album associated with it.
Uh-huh. Was that, so that was, I'm not familiar with it. That was protesting a nuclear plant?
I gotta look this up. I think it was silos or something. I guess weapons. I'm not sure.
Oh,
but
the missiles,
yeah.
The nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was
There's a lot
thing.
Of
you
overlap
know, in the
anti-nuclear
in the
energy and anti-nuclear weapons movements.
Yeah, remember, we went down at one point and protested for Nault, which is a, I believe a nuclear, I think it's a nuclear plant, but it's a storage facility for nuclear weapons waste as well.
Yeah.
But yeah. So when that lady, the whole time that lady was talking, Fun Boy 3 and Poison Girls were running in my head because they have songs on the album.
Oh, all right. Sounds like a cool album. Now, I understand you've been researching something that's not quite as fun, Parkinson's disease.
Yeah, Parkinson's disease, not a rocking good time. Apparently, like last, the 11th through 17th was Parkinson's Awareness Month, but it's still Parkinson's Awareness Month. So, gonna talk about it a little bit. Parkinson's disease is a neurodegenerative disorder affecting movement. So
being able to say neurodegenerative a test for a neurodegenerative disease?
I really hope not, but maybe. Okay. Of course, I've been reading this, and now I think I have Parkinson's, but you know, maybe that'll wear off. But
yeah, knock on wood.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
The early symptoms are tremors, stiffness, slowing of movement as the initial symptoms. You can lose facial expression, don't swing your arms when you walk, the speech soft or slurred. So right there we have it, I'm in trouble. Also, like, there can be a tick where people rub their thumbs against their forefinger a lot, which I'm now doing with our suggestion.
Okay.
And you can also have stooping, trouble with balance, trouble blinking, trouble writing. Eventually, with complications, you're going to get dementia, depression, anxiety, trouble swallowing, chewing, and eating. Insomnia, trouble with urination, blood pressure problems, weak sense of smell, or trouble identifying smells, fatigue, pain, and sexual dysfunction. So yeah, there's a reason nobody likes Parkinson's disease. Some of the risk factors can be some things you can do to decrease your risk. Actually, it might be associated with drinking caffeine, especially green tea, and aerobic exercise, although some of those links are still a little shaky, so not a guarantee. The causes, basically it's related to the death of nerve cells or neurons in the brain that produce dopamine, which we know from, you know, ADD. Dopamine is associated with doing stuff. So if you don't got dopamine, you have trouble doing stuff. But the causes are both genetic and environmental, and they think there's some association with changes in the brain, including having a lot of Lewy bodies, something called Lewy bodies, which have a protein called alpha-synuclein in them, apparently. Also, you get it when you're older, and males are at greater risk, apparently. So I mentioned environmental factors there. Yeah, the progress I should mention too is can be slowed, and the symptoms lessened with medication and sometimes surgery. But the first thing that you find when you Google Parkinson's disease, the second thing you find is the Mayo Clinic. The first thing you find is a bunch of lawyer ads, because I was wondering, you know, I thought I'd look this up. We'll see if it has any sort of environmental factors. Oh, yeah, it has a big one. Heavily associated with the use of the pesticide paraquat. No, sorry, not pesticide, herbicide, a.k.a. paraquat dichloride. It's in the herbicides Gramoxone, Firestorm, Helmquat, Parazone, Orthoparaquat, and others. And you can get it by handling or by spray drift. So if you're just downwind of this stuff, basically. If you live in a farmhouse, it's not good news. It's been used as a weed killer since the 1960s. Apparently, they use it a lot to clear away weeds before crop planting. So, you know, start with a clean slate there, except for it's not so clean. It's now banned in most countries. It's limited in this country to qualified, certified handlers as of 2019, mostly because of a bunch of people in 2017 on the Unified Parkinson's Advocacy Council called for that. There's been numerous studies. Apparently, being within 500 meters of paraquat being sprayed increases your risk for Parkinson's by 75%. So, yeah, that's really not good. We need to maybe think about not using that stuff anymore.
Yeah, I guess I understand it's also linked to the welding industry. People who weld with manganese are susceptible to it. Yeah, they also find high levels of PCBs in the brains of people who have Parkinson's, so it's not I joked about the disease, but unfortunately I actually lost my grandmother to Parkinson's, so I'm no fan of Parkinson's.
Yeah. And nobody likes it.
Nope. Just a reminder that all these things have consequences, and like Linda Gunter said, you know, there are faces behind these things. There are victims who really suffer from all these practices that we should have just banned that pesticide. We shouldn't have made it just, you know, you need to have a certificate. If it can affect anybody within 500 meters, it should not be around, period.
Okay. Basically, because, you know, healthy farm country living is not what it used to be anymore. Not to mention, I don't know, there's no proven link between having it, you know, on vegetables or whatever, but worries me a little.
Yeah, me too. All right. Well, thanks very much, Rebecca. And of course, stick around for the rest of the show, and anyone else can join Rebecca at B one last time at 866-240-1065. Okay, now on to environmental news and information. I'm going to start out with some good news. Our friend Mark Jacobson, who's been on the show before, talking about how it's perfectly practical to switch us over to complete wind, hydro, and solar, WWS, wind, water, and sun, had pointed out, he's been watching the figures, and yesterday, California hit 89% energy from wind, water, and solar, and geothermal.
Cool.
Yeah, I mean, it was 56% solar, 25% wind, 5% geothermal, which they have a you know, they can get some electricity out of geothermal, 3% hydro. And so just with those clean energy sources by itself, California, one of the biggest states of the union, one of the biggest energy users in the world, was able to supply 89% of their power. And so all these people that are saying it's impossible are just wrong. I don't know how many times we're going to have to repeat this. One note about that day, nuclear was supplying 5%. So, obviously, nuclear was not that big a contribution. Geothermal heating provided as much power, or geothermal electricity provided as much as nuclear. And so, you know, on our way to 100% clean and renewable, we're doing it in fits and starts. In some places, they're doing it better and faster than others. California is just running rings around Ohio. And we have a story on that later. It's really sad, but starting out with some good news. So we're on our way, folks. Big news, of course, environmentally this past week was Earth Day, and everybody had Earth Day announcements. And one of the cool things about being in the 21st century is that, of course, a lot of them were recorded, so you can go back and watch them. I would recommend, everybody from the Pope to Joe Biden, and I'd recommend Jane Goodall. She did an Earth Day statement that was kind of transcendent and spiritual, and in addition to just being, you know, cool and full of facts and stuff. Check out her website there, Jane Goodall. The House of Representatives had some hearings. It's the House Oversight Committee. They are finally considering the idea of eliminating all the tens of billions of dollars in subsidies that the oil and gas, that the carbon industries get every year. And we, you know, we've been calling, environmentalists have been calling for this for decades, you know, way back since the 90s. We've been saying, these industries are killing us, and yet you're subsidizing them. Why don't we take their subsidies and instead give them to the wind and the solar and so forth? So there were a lot of people who spoke at this Earth Day hearing. One, of course, was Greta Thunberg, who we're going to talk about a little more in a few minutes. Another was Tara Houska, and she is from the GNU Collective. And we've had people on from the GNU Collective before talking about the Line 3 controversy. And I just wanted to do a little experiment here. We don't actually know if this is technically going to work, so there might be a moment of silence here, but just hang on. I'm going to play her statement. Is that coming through, Rebecca? Can you hear it?
No, it is not. I don't hear anything.
Okay. All right. Well, that was a failure. She gave a very moving testimony talking about how the First Nations people are being hit the hardest by the effects of global warming, and yet they are the ones that are fighting the hardest against global warming technologies, trying to stop the pipelines. And they're also among the people that are the least responsible for what's happening, since a lot of them live in poverty and actually as a group put out much less carbon dioxide, much less, many fewer greenhouse gases than the rest of us. So very moving testimony. And like I say,
do they not own their own private jets, Joe?
Not many. Actually, yeah. None that I've ever
maybe
met.
Not.
You know, there might be some somewhere, but I've never met them. Okay, moving on. Biden's Earth Day announcement. He has announced that he's going to do 50 to 52% reduction from 2005 levels of CO2 by 2030. And he's talking about the economy-wide net carbon, so not just energy production, which is what a lot of people talk about, but you know, energy, agriculture, waste treatment, everything. So that is good. It's better than zero. He's being widely talked about in terms of not having enough. That's not actually enough to save us. So we have to keep going, and maybe it'll be kind of like his COVID vaccine, where he purposely set a low goal, and so we more than surpassed it. Kind of like Scotty always used to do on Star Trek, you know.
Cheer loudly for yourself when you achieve the low goal. Woohoo!
Yes. I mean, on Star Trek, Kirk would always say, Scotty, how much time do you need? And Scotty would say, oh, I cannot do it within a day. And then he'd have it done in an hour, and everybody would be like, wow, that's a miracle. And yeah, so maybe this is the game Biden's playing. I hope so.
I like that trick myself. Stress your incompetence to everyone, and then they'll be pleasantly surprised.
Right, when you actually manage to do stuff.
Yes.
Most of the statement, if you go to the White House website and look through what the official proclamation, and it is an Earth Day proclamation, most of it's pretty good. Couple problems. One is carbon capture technology. You know, there's no definite proof any of this carbon stuff, capture stuff, is going to work. I mean, and it takes energy to do carbon capture. So you're generating carbon in order to capture carbon, and to get to net capturing of carbon is going to take, you know, it's kind of like running in place. The first step is to switch to the clean energy sources. Then we can think about maybe taking excess carbon out.
You know, but what does not, you know what definitely works is not making so much carbon.
That's right. Yeah, not making carbon's the best.
We don't know about the capturing, but, you know, it does work if you don't make so much. We're sure about
this. But one thing I really did not like in it was that he announced the FIRST program, F-I-R-S-T. And basically, it's a program to start funding small modular nuclear reactors, which we've talked about those before. They're not practical from an economic, ecological, or energy point of view. And so the money put into the FIRST program is money that is wasted, money that is being kept from putting wind and solar and geothermal in. So that's a big mistake. It's not much money in terms of federal spending, but the one thing we've learned about the nuclear industry, you let them, that anything you give them is like the camel's nose and under the tent. The rest of the camel will soon be in the tent with you. So wow. I didn't like that, but most of it was good. So there were a lot of special events, mostly virtual. Greta Thunberg ran a special on PBS called A Year to Change the World, which, of course, you can go to PBS website and watch it yourself. It was kind of depressing, but it was a good thing to watch. One thing I learned from it that I did not know before is that the process, the idea that you can store carbon just by planting trees, and so has some basic problems with it. That the basic problem is that if you cut down an existing forest, it turns out that that forest becomes a carbon source rather than a carbon sink. It actually emits carbon because all that wonderful topsoil that's under the trees will spend the next 30 years evaporating into the sun and putting carbon dioxide into the air. And so if you cut down a forest and then plant new trees, it takes about 20 years before the new trees start absorbing carbon in a rate that makes the whole area carbon neutral. And then it takes another 20 years before you've reabsorbed the carbon that you emitted by cutting down the original forest. So planting trees is great, but cutting down an existing forest and then planting new little seedlings, that is terrible because it'll take 40 to 60 years for you to get net carbon loss, you know, to net take some carbon out of the atmosphere. So that was a little thing I found very interesting. A quarter of our greenhouse gases come from food production. And as we've talked about before, most of our food production goes to making meat, goes to raising cattle, you know, raising the food to feed to the cattle, to feed to us. So cutting out, reducing your meat consumption can have a big effect on that. And they also talked a lot about carbon capture technology again, which we're going to have to do a whole show on that. But one of the main things Greta Thunberg talks about and says is that right now our leaders are saying the right thing but doing the wrong thing. And that's reflected in the fact that even though there's been a Paris Agreement, even though all these countries have committed to starting to cut their carbon, globally our carbon has continued to increase right along the same graph that it's always been. Even though some countries really are doing the right thing, most countries are continuing to do what the U.S. does, which is still on the sly, give these subsidies to fossil fuel industries and so forth. So that was some, but it was definitely worth watching. Other news, big problem in the Balkans. They have the Drina and Lim rivers have been flooding because, like a lot of other parts of the world, they've been getting the intense flash floods and intense rainstorms. The difference is that they, in the area, Serbia, Bosnia, Herzegovina, they have dumped, they've created dumps right alongside the river, which is not a good plan because the dumps then flood. All the trash is getting carried into the rivers. And then I wanted to talk about this story because we've talked about synergy before, where doing things the right way, you know, once you start producing electricity with solar or wind, you discover other things kind of fall in line and you can cut your carbon even faster. It's the opposite is also true. If you do something unecological, you know, that hurts the environment, like putting your dumps right next to your rivers, what happens now is that the rivers flood. They take all the trash, gets floated into the river by the flood, gets carried downstream, and they block the hydroelectric dam, which is the major source of electricity for the whole region.
And so
right now what they're doing is this crazy thing where they're trying to put up booms to catch the trash, and then they have front end loaders and trucks, so they're trying to take the trash out of the river, put it back in the trucks, but then they just drive it right back into the same dumps again because those are the only dumps they have. So doing things the wrong way can also have synergistic effects. So let's hope they're trying to get into the EU, those countries, but these kinds of issues are some of the things that are blocking them.
Right, I would think so.
U.S., we have our own disaster area, Kentucky.
Boy.
Yeah, one of the things President Biden did on the April 23rd was declare parts of Kentucky a disaster area because they've had incredible flooding back there in March.
Which parts?
Southeastern.
Okay. I lived in Western Kentucky, 4th through 6th grade. I was wondering, there the land between the lakes thing where there's a dam created that created Kentucky Lake and all that stuff.
Yeah,
we went there a lot, and you had to watch out for water moccasins when you jumped in the water.
Oh, really? Okay.
So, yeah.
So what do you do? Do you like splash in the water to get rid of them, or does that attract them? Or
use your eyes or chuck
just
a big stick in, see what starts slithering,
All right. Well, we've got just two more stories to go to. We've got 5 minutes to do it. I think we can do this. Japan has announced that they're going to dump all their radioactive water that they've got piled up around the Fukushima plant into the ocean, and it is creating a huge diplomatic brouhaha. Everybody from China to North Korea and South Korea are saying, hey, that's our ocean too.
Right.
Unfortunately, the Biden administration is saying, oh, okay.
Sure, Biden.
Can go ahead and do that. Because the whole thing about this controversy is that this one is completely unnecessary because the water is contaminated with tritium, which is the radioactive form of hydrogen. But it only has a 10-year half-life. So if you could store the water for 100 years, it becomes not radioactive. The radiation disappears. So this is one where literally all you have to do is set it on a shelf, and you can concentrate the tritium because tritium has a higher evaporation point than regular water. So you can kind of boil off the regular water to some degree, concentrate the tritium, and then if you store that for one century, which sounds like a lot, but in terms of nuclear waste, it's like nothing. And then you won't have the radioactivity.
But this is a species that decides to put it in garbage dumps near rivers. So, one worries.
Good point. So let's hope that the U.S. comes to its senses and joins many, many other countries that are telling Japan, don't do this. And if the U.S. says don't do it, the Japanese won't do it. I'm pretty confident. So, all right. Now, one more bit of news for here in Ohio. This is a semi-HB6 update here. One of the members of the House who was most rabidly pro-HB6, Dick Stein, and he and I actually had some back and forths during the hearings where he was making these outlandish claims, which were just false. But, you're standing there at a podium and you're telling the truth, and the guy on the other side is just saying something. It's called gaslighting, just saying something that's so false that you're like, what?
Oh, but kangaroos can fly, Joe.
Yeah, pigs can fly. Right. What? No. So Governor DeWine has just appointed him to the Ohio Power Siting Board.
Now DeWine.
Which is the most powerful entity in terms of approving or disapproving wind and solar projects. And at the same time, he just introduced a bill that would prevent wind and solar projects from getting put into a place in Ohio, because that's the one calling for the referendum system for townships to let anybody basically who doesn't like wind or solar block it from happening by calling for a referendum. So DeWine, you know, he had to replace Sam Randazzo, who got thrown in jail, or who's not thrown in jail. He's suspected of being involved in House Bill 6 controversy. And Dick Stein, who was up to his ears in House Bill 6, is now on the Ohio Power Siting Board. So DeWine has shown himself to be anti-wind, anti-solar, and he couldn't have done it in a more direct way. All right. Well, that's about it. As I said at the start, next week we're going to be back on 100.7, which will then become The Ticket. And thanks very much for listening. This is Joe DeMar.
And Rebecca Wood.
And we're signing off.
I don't want them nukes. Run by them kooks who think radioactivity is fun. No more three-headed frogs or kids with leukemia.